Welcome to this video. It will be a quick video where we will see some sort of an example of this really applying the representations of the Lorentz group. So these bispinor representations. So the idea is we found four solutions of the Dirac equation, and these solutions they were valid for any momentum that we take, because we essentially had this sigma dot p over omega plus m term. So any momentum, we can orient our spin along that direction to get the desired solution. But this is in general not always feasible, particularly if we try finding the solutions using a whale basis. We will see that it is not possible to actually find the solutions like this. So the solution will look a bit different in the whale basis. So what we can do is we can really take the fact that we have a representation of Lorentz group seriously. So the idea is, if you remember, if you stand at a space time and then you perform a Lorentz boost, you can go to different Lorentz frames. So similarly, this is just this is also a representation of Lorentz group, and if you allow it to act on particles, it will take you to different frames of this particle. Particles is not the correct word, because we really don't have particles till now prior to quantization. So anyway, but the solution, any classical solution also, that is a bispinor. So these representations can act on that solution and can boost them, and they can boost them in different kind of directions with different kind of momenta. So that's what we can check now. So the idea is, the Lorentz representation was of this form. You can check the video 22, and a lot of results from this video will be used here. So suppose this is the generator of this Lorentz transformation looks like this, and where these gamma mu nu, they are just the gamma matrices that satisfy the Clifford algebra. So let's check some intuition then. So consider the particle solutions. We have discussed them many times. And particularly consider a particle solution in the Dirac basis, that is along a 0, 0 pz direction. So it is kind of like a particle traveling in positive z direction with this much momenta. So what we do is we simply take our solutions that has sigma dot p there, and just put the vector p. It collapses into this kind of a sigma 3 or sigma z operator. And then you further choose these chi quantities to be your eigenvalues of sigma z operator, so that these u1, u2, they are also eigenstates of your helicity operator, that is just s dot p hat. And now what you do is, you just simply write these solutions in this particular form here. So the plus stands for chi plus here, and the minus stands for chi minus. So I have been calling them chi 1, chi 2. You can call them chi plus, chi minus, to really signify the fact. The fact that you have acted with the sigma 3 below here. Sigma 3 acting on this is plus 1, but sigma 3 acting on u2 will be a minus sign, because the eigen value is negative. So essentially what we can do is, now we consider, so at this moment you say that, well, this is a solution, so a linear combination of these solutions will be a solution of a particle that has a momentum of this form, and you are done with the problem. But if we look at it from a different view, so look, suppose you don't have this solution, suppose this solution is absent. But rather what you have is a solution that is valid for a particle that is at rest. So the p vector is really a 0, 0, 0. So if you put it in sigma dot p term that sits in the denominator for the particle solutions, you will end up getting a 0. But the numerator will be free, and essentially we have a 2 degree of freedom, the Hilbert space of dimension 2, and you get this. So we have two solutions, particle solutions of particles at rest. And if particle is at rest, then omega is equal to m, because omega square minus p square is m square, and omega must be greater than 0, energies are positive. And essentially you have created the solution, the plane wave solution of particles at rest, by explicitly including the plane wave term. And now the idea is you have obtained a solution at rest. You want to obtain a solution that is boosted with a momentum pz, suppose. So pz is means 0 0 pz. So if it was your special relativity course, we would just say, well, we take a solution that is at rest, we apply our Lorentz boost, and we get a solution that is moving, but that is moving in this space-time, because we will be applying a different representation of Lorentz group, but this is a different representation of Lorentz group that is acting on bispinors. So essentially, you end up getting the same picture, that you can boost your rest frame solutions to go to a moving frame. So now just simply try to find that solution. So we take a boost. So we take a boost along z direction. So this is the Lorentz matrix for the boost. This matrix is what we all know in one time three space coordinates. This is the matrix that will perform the boost. So why we need this matrix? Because we actually need to extract this omega term here. And if you remember, these omega terms were precisely connected, like you expanded the Lorentz group in some sense into identity plus a little transformations along that around that identity, and from there we got these omega mu s while we were constructing the representation. So I just need to extract that omega from there. But this representation and this here, they are not same. So given this representation, you take a small boost. So the parameter eta is very small. So you get identity plus a little transformation around identity. So because cos eta for eta very very small is 1, and this is also 1, so you get an identity along the diagonal, and added to that identity you will have a matrix of minus eta and minus eta. So these are our omegas, the small transformations that connect to the identity. So now what we do is we need omega 0 3. What we have is omega 0 3. So we need to take care of our indices, but that is easily obtained by using your metric that will pull it down. So essentially you perform this sum that I have written here. So sum over this mu, and mu equal to 0 will be the only term that survives, because here also the only non-zero terms are 0, 3 or 3, 0, and you will get minus eta. So this is omega 0 3. Omega 3 0 will be plus eta, because you are essentially you will essentially be pulling down a different quantity, right? I mean, I hope that is clear, because here you will have g 0 0 to be plus 1, but g 3 3 will be minus 1. So now what it means is that when you will, so there is a summation over mu and s here and here. So as you sum over mu and s, the terms 0 omega 0 3 s 0 3 and omega 30 s 30 survives. But essentially the omega 03 is opposite of omega 30 and s 03 is opposite of s 30. So using the symmetry property, you can say that you will have 2 times omega 03 s 03 that will kill this 2 here. So essentially what this means is, on performing a small Taylor expansion of this exponential sign or basically this representation, we end up getting something of this form. Now omega 03 is known, s 03 is just this thing here, so you have here. So essentially you have a small transformation. So now for finite boost, it is not difficult to see that the transformation will be just that whose first term is this Taylor expansion. So that is this cosh eta by 2 plus sine eta by 2. So because if you expand cos eta by 2, it will give you up to first order 1, and sine eta by 2 give you eta by 2. So you end up getting this particular thing here. So this is my generator of Lorentz boost for a bispinner, such that the generator is boosting along the PZ direction. But if I want to boost along arbitrary direction, the generalization will simply be take a dot product with the unit vector along the direction you want to boost. And strangely, this quantity that I have written, so lambda half boost, not for rotation. So for boost, this quantity is actually valid for any basis. So whatever your basis is, just put in that gamma 0 and the gamma i's and you are done. So essentially, moving on, what we can do is now we can just expand this lambda half for a basis where I have just gamma 3. So it is particle is traveling along the traveling with a velocity of pz. So I get something like this. Now I simply apply this solution onto my state that was at rest. So my rest solution was this thing here. Okay, so as I apply, you see I have got up till here. Now it is not hard to see that this is actually the same solution, almost the same solution that we have obtained initially. So this solution was obtained directly from the Dirac equation. This solution was obtained indirectly by boosting the rest solution. So to see this, what you do is you take your cos eta by 2 outside, you take a tan eta by 2 inside, and essentially you just see that your cos eta by 2 and tan eta by 2, they are related in this particular fashion. So cos eta is the Lorentz factor 1 over under root 1 minus v square over c square, and sin eta by 2 is gamma times the Lorentz factor times your velocity's ratio. And then you can just perform this calculation that I have shown here. So essentially what you do is you take this half angle formula of cos eta, and then what you do is you replace cos eta by gamma, and then use the fact that gamma is related to the energy omega by a m factor, because energy is basically equal to mc square over under root 1 minus v square over c square, but c is 1 everywhere. So energy is basically m times gamma. So it turns out we end up getting the same form. We end up getting the same form of the solution that we had obtained initially. So this was a small example of how to really apply your boost. So what we did was really we took this boost and calculated the element that will bring this boost in explicit matrix form here. So that's all for this video.